On Saturday, April 30th, 2022, I attended the Midwest Gaming Classic at the Wisconsin Center in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Among the pinball machines, arcade games, retro computers, and consoles, I met Harold Johnson, the renowned Dungeons & Dragons alumni who started with the company in 1978. He worked closely with founder Gary Gygax and was copy editor for the original Dungeon Master's Guide. He also created tournaments for TSR that eventually were developed into modules A2, Secret of the Slavers Stockade, and C1, The Hidden Shrine of Tamoachan. He is currently promoting a new module that he created called Return to Tamoanchan. He was kind enough to sign these items for me and share some stories about his past. Here is a portion of the conversation that we had at the convention.
Am I remembering correctly, you're the guy that came up with the box tech?
Actually, yes. Box tech was me. What happened was, when I was there, a little known fact, in 1978, Gary started hiring people. And he posted for I applied. Not get the job because I applied like 2 months after they already did something. And then he decided he didn't have the ability to lead the D&D line anymore. He needed to be running the company. So he asked us to be, he put out a position for the lead writer of Dungeons and Dragons. And I called him back and said, remember me? And he said, yeah, we would be happy to have you. I said, cool. So what do I have to do? Well, here's a 100-question test. What? It was all historical questions like count, viscount, duke, marquis, earl, prince. Put them in order. We didn't have the internet. But I went to Northwestern. I had Love's Library.
Okay.
So I, and then you had to give them a sample adventure. So I designed what has never been published, the only living dungeon. It was a frost giant's tower, but the rooms were descriptive, but the occupants moved around based on the time of day. So the monsters are over here with personalities and so on, and the descriptions are over here, and it's what time of day is it? And I also introduced creatures called the Thusser, which is out of lore. The Thusser are transparent during daylight, so they're invisible servants, essentially. But at night, they become visible. And so you had servants doing stuff, but you can't see them. You know, things are floating through the air and stuff.
Right.
So I never finished that. Because after 2 months, I went up to Winter Fantasy, and they said, we've hired someone. Or at least a friend said, he hired someone. They hired Lawrence Schick to write Star Frontiers.
But they
hadn't,
that one too.
Yeah, but they hadn't hired for my position. So when I got home, there's a letter from Gary, and it was like, well, you know, we're looking forward to seeing your guys' stuff. The deadline is this date. And by the way, here's another 50 questions. So I worked in a garage, in a car park garage. So I said, park car hop. And so late at night, I would be typing on a typewriter at work. And in those days, the post office was open until after midnight. So I made a beeline to the post office, got it dated, and got it off on the day it was supposed to be there, or post dated by. And on February 9th, 1979, I got a letter from him. My grandfather died the year before, on February 9th. It was the same day. And so I'm sitting there going, and I had lived with my grandfather. So I'm sitting there going, I don't know. I don't need more rejection in my life. Thank you very much. I know they're going to die. So it takes me about 45 minutes of pacing around, building up the nerve to actually open the letter. And it says, thank you very much for your offering. This is really great. And thank you. Oh, by the way, questions were near perfect. take-home test. But it really is your adventure that intrigues us. I think it should be published as its own product. Nobody had ever been published by Gary Gygax from the company. It's offering to publish my adventure. Yeah, because I had it off to the side. Anyway, and he goes, but Tim Cass wants to publish it in Dragon Magazine. So we're kind of fighting as to where it should be. Oh, and by the way, job yours. By the way! So, but I never was the lead writer because the editor quit. And they were in the midst of Dungeon Master's Guide and said, we need you desperately. Apply to be an editor. Can you come up and be our editor for the piece? So Mike Carr and I were the editors on this thing. And every time there was something missing, I go down to Gary and I say, Gary, there's stuff missing here. Show me the table and we'll make sure it's in there. And he says, oh, I didn't do the table. I like this edition because it's every random dungeon that you can generate a random dungeon. Here at the end of Artifacts, I think it's at the end. Possible destructions. Okay. This is all me. This was up this long of different ways you can destroy an artifact.
It got edited down.
Well, it didn't get edited. In those days, they typeset it all, and then they're waxing the paper and going to put it down on the page. That's how we did it in those days. And he says, oh, this is too long. And he took it to his threw that in the trash, and this is what survived. And I thought, I did 100 things, because it's multiple things here. And I said, whatever happened to the rest of that, I guess I'll never know. Last month, I'm turning over my collection to an auction house. I'm getting it, right? I better set it up. And I came across the letter that where you can see I was offered the job. And the full thing.
Oh, wow.
I have it. I have them now. And when I went up there, because they thought all I was an editor, because they didn't know I'd been offered the lead writer position. And they said, well, Gary's supposed to write Origins, but we don't have time for him to write it. So who here wants to write the tournament for Origins? And every designer said, I'm too busy, can't do it. And I said, I'll do it. And they were going, is he nuts? He's like, no, I'll do it. He said, no, know that was a writer. And that became C1.
Okay.
That's where that came from. So, yep. So there you go.
Yeah, I love the A1 before.
You had somebody writing in it.
Well, that's my name I wrote.
Oh, there. Okay.
I'm not famous
you
enough
left
to
your
sign
name
my
there.
Own, sign my own book. And then this one, the C1 I got used in, apparently there was another book of illustrations that I never got, so I'll have to track that down.
It was an accident.
Because I remember there was the Tomb of Horrors that had another book of illustrations.
Yep, too. That's how I came to doing that, because I had Tomb of Horrors, and I said, I'm going to do that. And they said, that's cool. And then when I was trying to do it, they said, we don't have any art. We don't have any artists. I said, what? We can't have art. What do you mean I can't have art? Okay, so I'm a draftsman. So I go home, pull out all my comic books, look around till I can find something similar, and I penciled out for the pictures. And those, and I took them back in and Dave suddenly said, who did these? You can draw. I said, no, I can copy. He's going, you mind if I ink these? So in the collectible edition, you'll find the art, and at the bottom it says, DCS3, which is David Sutherland III, HJJ.
Okay.
So I'm actually...
This ends the portion of our conversation. If you would like to see more video of the Midwest Gaming Classic, I provided a link to that. Also, if you would like to find out more about Harold Johnson, check out Peter Adkinson's interview with him.